Worship Jam 2018, make some noise! No, 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 stop, stop, stop. No, what was that? Do you guys love Jesus or do you guys love Jesus? Worship Jam 2018, make some noise! Woo! I still don't like it. We're not gonna stop. We're not gonna stop until I like it. Worship Jam, make some noise if you love Jesus! These usually get louder as they go. You guys can take a seat. All right, sit down. All right. I guess that was kind of a rough transition, huh? Going from that amazing song to screaming and stuff. Anyways, hey, welcome to Worship Jam 2018. My name is Daniel. Welcome to Encounter. We're so glad that you could be here today with us and to worship with us and to experience all of this. It's such an honor and pleasure to be able to speak in front of you and to bring the Word of God to you today. I want to start off with an exercise that I hope you guys could help me with. There's been a time in my life where I remember I was in pain and I was in despair, and I asked God to intervene into my life, and it felt like He was distant. And it felt like He wasn't there. Has anybody experienced that? Yeah? Okay, I see some few nods, a few hands. I need you to come up with that scenario and just have it in your head. And we'll come back to it later on in the talk. But while you guys do that, I want to share a quick story with you of when that happened to me. I started to go to college at Calvin College here, and I walked into the gym, and I saw this massive, massive rock wall. And I knew immediately that's what I wanted to do in college. I saw this, and I started to climb, and I realized that there's different levels of climbing. There's, you know, you have your regular rock climbing, but then you also have, like, sport climbing. You have trad climbing, where you're placing gear as you're going up the wall, and then you have this thing called big wall climbing. Anybody know what big wall climbing is? No one? Okay, so big wall climbing is you have this bag, and then you've put all your food and your water and, like, clothes and stuff like that, and you carry it with you on your climb, and you have this system where you pull up the bag, and you basically sleep on the side of the wall while you're climbing up the wall because it's such a long climb, right? So for me coming in, there's pictures if you guys want to. Can we throw up one of those pictures? For me coming into it, I was like, I want to be the best. Right, I want to be the best rock climber that ever was and the best rock climber that's ever been. And I thought doing stuff like this was how you became the best, right? So my buddy and I, we went out and bought a bunch of gear with money we didn't have but bought stuff that we didn't know how to use, and we put it all into a car and we went to Yosemite. Because in all the videos that we watched about rock climbing, for some reason they're in Yosemite. So I'm like, I guess that's where we got to go. And we got to Yosemite, and we started to experiment with big wall climbing and figure out, okay, so yeah, there's my buddy Spencer and I were on top of a climb that we did. And I want to tell you about one of these experiences where I'm going up one of these routes. It was on Washington Column, and my buddy and I, we had planned to climb for 3 days. And we got up there, and we did good. You know, we did it in good style. We did it in good form. And we got to the top, but we got there a bit later than we wanted to. So usually what you would do is pack up your bags and then hike up to the top and then come down the backside of the mountain. We're like, no, no, no. We're short on time. We need to expedite this process. We're going to rappel down the side of this mountain. So for those of you who don't know what rappelling is, you basically clip your rope to, like, an anchor point, and then you have all of your gear, and then you just, like, go down to the end of the rope. And then once you get to the end of the rope, you, like, clip yourself back into the wall, you pull your rope down, thread it through, and then rinse and repeat, and you do that over and over again. Our plan was to rappel down the entire length of the climb that we had just done, that had taken us 3 days. I thought I'd do it 9, 10 times, okay? So the first time, I'm coming down off the side of this mountain, and we realized almost immediately that we had made a bad decision. But it's one of those decisions that you can't really go back on. Right, you just start doing it and you got to finish it out to the end. We made a bad decision because there was a lot of bushes coming out of the side of the wall. There was a lot of cracks in the climb. So when we would pull the rope would get stuck, like, around a branch, or it would get stuck inside of a crack or something like that. So we would have to climb back up there. You can't weight the rope, because if you weight the rope and you're climbing up the rope, it falls out, then you fall, and then you're in big trouble. So we would have to climb back up and, like, get it off of the snag or get it off. And then this happened, like, 3 or 4 times, and it took, like, 2 hours each time to get it unstuck. Okay, so we're tired and we're hungry, and we're just like mad at each other, even though it's no fault of our own. And it's like, we're supposed to be down by 8 p.m. It's like 12:30 in the morning. And we're just so angry and mad at the situation, okay? And I remember it was the second to last rappel we had to do. And we were sitting there and we were so exhausted. And my buddy Spencer looks over to me and he goes, Spencer, he's not really a religious guy, right? He looks over at me and he goes, dude, I think we should pray. And I was like, sweet, man, go for it. So Spencer, verbatim, I remember the prayer. He said, God, please don't let the rope get stuck. Amen. And I was like, amen, all right. And he starts pulling the rope down. And about 20 seconds later, I see his arm do this. And he's off, he's angry, he like blows up, and he's angry at the entire situation. Rope gets stuck, we're down, it's like 5 o'clock in the morning, we're frustrated, we're upset. It's easy to laugh about it now, but when I was going through the process, we were in despair. We had to do some sketchy things to like get down and not die on that mountain, right? And at that time, I remember coming back down and talking to my friends and my buddies. We're telling this story, and he said something along the lines of, yeah, I remember I prayed, and God didn't answer our call for help. He didn't do anything. He didn't show up when we were in pain and when we were in despair. I feel like we all have those instances that we could relate to where we're in pain and we're in suffering, and we ask God to help us, and we ask Jesus to come into our lives and save us, and all we get is crickets, right? I feel like I see all of you, and you know it wasn't too long ago when I was in junior high school or high school, but I remember it was a hard time in my personal life. I had to deal with some bullies at school. I had to deal with figuring out who I was and who I wanted to become, and you know SATs and classes are getting harder. And I remember it was a hard time in my life, but I also can't resonate with some of the things that you guys are going through as well. I know social media is definitely big. I can't imagine what kind of influence that has on people who are still trying to figure out who they are. We know that this is an epidemic. We know that it releases dopamine in your brain, and you go back to it over and over again, the bing, the bleeps, whatever happens with your phone. We all have one of these now. Super addictive. If you're trying to understand who you are, whose you are, who you're trying to become, this sets a very unrealistic perception of what society wants you to be, and that's hard. I spent a lot of time on MySpace when I was your age. You guys know what that is? It's kind of like the CD back in the days. Instagram wasn't a thing. I don't even think they developed it. Snapchat didn't even come around. I didn't have any of these things. Zanga and MySpace was my jam. So yeah, there's that. There's instances in your life that's hard. You're dealing with a lot of things that kids honestly shouldn't be dealing with. I turned on the news and I hear there's a nationwide protest being formed to march against our leaders in this country, because there's a lot of students here that are scared that their school might be next. This is unfathomable. Never would I have ever thought that it would come to the point where kids are out marching in the streets. You guys are dealing with a lot of things right now that I couldn't even imagine what it must be like. And it's hard and it's difficult. And you're asking hard questions of where is God in all of this? Jesus, if you had just been here, you could have done something about that. I want to turn to our text for today, because there's a situation very similar in here. And Jesus addresses it in the most epic way possible. So if there's Bibles underneath the seat, the words are going to be in the screen behind me. But go ahead and turn to John chapter 11. In your books, if you have a house Bible, it should be page 749. John chapter 11, page 749 is what it says. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now, Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Mary and Martha to comfort them in the loss of their brother. Let's just pause there for a second. I just want to give you guys a quick idea of what's going on. So we're in John chapter 11. John chapter 10, Jesus is in Jerusalem. He's preaching. He's teaching. People are listening to him. People are following him. He's doing miracles. He's doing things that defeats the status quo. The people that are in charge at the time don't like this. The spotlight's been taken away from them. And they basically run Jesus out of town, chasing him with rocks. So that's how chapter 10 ends. Chapter 11 begins, and we are introduced to these four characters. We have Jesus, we have Lazarus, we have Martha and Mary. Martha and Mary, sisters of Lazarus. Lazarus, homeboys with Jesus. That's all you need to know. Jesus and Lazarus are best buds, okay? It's like they probably had Thanksgiving together and hung out on the weekends. Think about what you would do with your friends. That's who Jesus and Lazarus was. Mary and Martha see that Jesus isn't in town, and they send word to go get Jesus because Lazarus is dying, and Jesus is literally the only person in the world that could do something about it. But Jesus rolls into town, and Lazarus has been dead, as the text says, for 4 days. There's two things that are important about the mentioning of 4 days. Number one, in Jewish tradition, in Jewish history, they believed that the soul, after the body died, hung around for about 3 days. They said maybe things turn for the better, the soul could go back in, the person comes, awakes from the sleep, bada bing, bada boom. But on the fourth day, the soul departs, and then they're not like kind of dead, they're like really dead, like not 100% dead. So when the scripture tells us that Jesus showed up after 4 days, it's telling us that all people believed that nothing could be done physically and nothing could be done spiritually for this man. He is 100% dead. It also tells us that Jesus was 4 days late to the party. We're talking about the Son of Man here. And he is away, and his best friend is dying, and he is literally the only person that could do something about it. And he ends up coming 4 days late. Can you imagine what it must be like to be Mary and Martha in this situation? Well, you don't have to, because that's what's coming up next. It says in the text, when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed home. Why do you think Mary stayed home? She's angry, right? She's upset. I'm not going to give you the time of the day. Jesus, you could have done something about that. And you decided to show up 4 days late. Mary is angry, but Martha, her emotional cocktail is just right that she wants to be confrontational. She goes out there and she talks to Jesus. She said, Jesus, Lord, if you had been there, my brother would not have died. Jesus, if you had been there, my brother, your best friend, wouldn't be dead right now. And as a way of reading into this story, I want you to take that scenario you came up with at the beginning of this talk. I want you to take that scenario and just put it right in there. Read yourself into this, because we're all Marthas in this story. Jesus, if you had been there, my relationship with my mom wouldn't be where it's at right now. Jesus, if you had been there, I wouldn't have to deal with the garbage that I'm dealing with at school. Jesus, if you had been there, I wouldn't be being bullied. Jesus, if you had been there, you could have done something about that. I want us to read into this story. I want us to read into this story because it instills anger in us. We're angry, right? And I feel like as Christians, we're often told it's okay to talk to God about all of the different emotional stuff you have. But for anger, for some reason, it's not acceptable to talk to God about your anger. When you're angry at him. When you're happy, when you're confused, when you're sad, you're lonely, whatever emotions that you're feeling, it's okay to talk to God. But when it comes to anger, we can't say anything. And I feel like that's something that needs to change in our society today, in our faith today. Because you see, you go to the Bible and you see a lot of people who are angry at God, a lot of people who are wrestling with God, a lot of people who have questions, who are in pain and lament, and they shout out to God. Half of the Old Testament is minor prophets, God's people, nation, under captivity, and they're shouting out, God, these are your people, why aren't you doing something about this? There's a book in the Bible called Lamentations. It's one of the only books where God doesn't speak at all. It's a collection of poems and writings where people are just mad and upset, and they're in lament, hence Lamentations. Even King David, right? One of the most celebrated biblical figures, King David, writes some of the most heart-wrenching psalms. I brought one for you as an example, Psalm 88. It says this, "From my youth I have suffered and been close to death. You have borne your terrors. I have borne your terrors and am in despair. Your wrath has swept over me. Your terrors have destroyed me. All day long, they surround me like a flood. They have completely engulfed me. You have taken from me my friend and my neighbor. And this is how he ends it. Psalm 88, darkness is my closest friend. And he just signs off. See, a lot of people have been angry at God. A lot of people have expressed their anger at God. But there's one key component you got to understand in doing this. They did it out of faith. That makes sense, right? They're angry at God because if God couldn't do anything about it, there's no reason. If they didn't believe that God could do something about it, they wouldn't be angry at God. They believe that Jesus, you could have done something about that. That's why they're being angry. And they have that wrestle and they build that relationship. See, anger and faith is what these people bring. And Martha comes to Jesus and she says, if you had been there, if he had been there, my brother would not have died. And Jesus responds with something amazing. He says in verse 23, your brother will rise again. Martha, your brother will rise again. Isn't that the Christian hope? That the dead may rise again? Isn't that what we all believe in? That the people that we have loved and cared for, that when they pass away, we have a belief that they will be risen again from the death, that the resurrection power of Jesus Christ is here with us today. Isn't that the gospel message? Like, I'm powerful, Martha. I can do this. Your brother will rise again. There is resurrection hope, Martha. Martha just kind of looks at her feet. She's a bit dejected. I know, Martha answered. I know he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. See, I see her saying these words more to convince herself than anybody else, that these words are true and have meaning. See, what Martha here is thinking is that God, Jesus, is saying that Your brother will rise again at the end times with the rest of humanity, the rest of followers of Jesus. They will all rise again and we will go to heaven and we'll celebrate with God forever. Martha is thinking Jesus is saying what we often hear in the visiting room and in funeral homes, that he's in a better place, Martha. He's with God. The pain and suffering here is over. And I'm not going to stand here and deny that. In fact, if you read the Bible, if you read the Word of God, I have every reason to believe that is true. But Jesus wasn't talking about some distant theological concept in the future, the then and there. He was talking about here and now. He was saying that the resurrection was going to happen now. Look at what Jesus has to say in verse 25. It says, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Jesus takes the this is groundbreaking stuff, guys. I have a professor that teaches this. He was telling me about this story, and I've never seen somebody lose it like in class like that. He was like, this is amazing news. Because what Jesus has done here, he's taken resurrection, right? This abstract theological concept way out that's going to happen in the future. And he's grabbed it and he's brought it and he says, no, the resurrection is going to happen now. When Jesus comes into your life right now, the restorative process happens. And by you being restored, you are taking part in restoring this broken world. And a slice of heaven is being brought and you experience God on earth. The resurrection is happening now. The resurrection is happening now. This is exciting stuff, guys. Can I get an amen? The resurrection is happening now. And then Jesus turns to Martha and he asks perhaps the most important question in human history. Jesus turns to Martha and he asks a question that is easy to answer when you're 6 years old and you really don't know what's going on in this world. Jesus asks a question that becomes a bit harder when you're a teenager and you're trying to figure everything out and you have these unrealistic scenarios that you got to live up to that can't ever happen. You got people asking you, why do you believe in all of this? And the only good answer you could give is because my parents forced me to go to church. Jesus asks Martha a question That gets harder and harder when you turn 36 and you've experienced the pain and the grief that comes with all of life. Jesus asked a question that is darn near impossible to answer confidently when you're 56 and you buried your family members. They're 6 feet under. Jesus turns to Martha and he asks, "Do you believe this? Do you believe that I am the resurrection and the life? Do you believe that death loses its eternal significance when I enter into the scene? Do you believe this?" So friends, I have to ask you, do you believe this? Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the manifestation of resurrection and hope in our lives? Do you believe this? Do you believe when he enters into our hearts, the restorative process happens? The resurrection isn't something that's happening solely in the then and there. Jesus grabbed it, he brought it to us today, and it's happening here and now. Do you believe this? Or is that scenario that you came up with at the beginning of this talk stopping you from confidently shouting out, "Yes, I do believe. Give me faith in my unbelief"? If that's the case, there's a connection card. There's a connection card in the backseat pocket of the seats. I urge you to grab one. I urge you to grab a pen and just write it down. Write down what's stopping you from experiencing heaven on earth here today. We have prayer leaders in the back. Your youth leaders are here with you. They want to pour into you. They want to do this walk of life with you. Because none of us can do this alone. Jesus asked Martha, "Do you believe this?" And today I'm not going to tell you what Martha said. You're going to have to go home and pull out a Bible and read it for yourself. I know, it's crazy. I'm not going to tell you what Martha said because I believe when the Holy Spirit was speaking through John, the author of this gospel message and the eyewitness account of what happened, when the Holy Spirit was speaking through John, I think he cared less about what Martha said then. I think he cared more about what you're going to say here today. Do you believe that death loses its internal significance when Jesus entered into this scenario? Do you believe that the gospel power has hope and resurrection power in your life? And the second it enters into your heart, the restorative processes brings heaven on earth here today. Do you believe that? Listen. Mary wasn't the only sister. Martha wasn't the only sister. And for some of us, we need a little bit more. And for those that need a little more, we have Mary. In verse 32, it says, "When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, 'Lord, if you had been there, my brother would not have died.'" True words. "When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. 'Where have you laid them?' he asked. 'Come and see, Lord,' they replied." One of the most powerful verses in this entire passage, verse 35, says, "Jesus wept." And if you're in pain right now, if you're suffering, if there's a Lazarus in your life, let these words just roll over you as the Holy Spirit whispers into your ear, "I know. I've been there. I've done that. I know the pain. I know it stings. I know it hurts. Jesus wept." Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across its entrance, not unlike his very own in the near future. Then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, But I said this for the benefit of the people standing here. And I say this for the benefit of everybody that's here right now. And I say this for the benefit of the church that lasted for thousands, that will last for thousands and thousands of years after my death and resurrection, as your glory changes the brokenness in this world. I pray for all of those people too, that they may believe that you sent me. And when he had said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice, and he said something nobody expected. I need everybody on their feet right now. Verse 44, he said, "Lazarus, come on out." And in this time, in this moment, time stood still. Because there's only one of two things that could have happened. If the dead man didn't come out, then we know, you, me, everybody, we've wasted our lives. We know if the dead man doesn't come out, we know that billions and billions of people have wasted their lives. We know that Jesus doesn't have the resurrection power and that he isn't the Son of God if the dead man doesn't come out. But if the dead man does come out, if the dead man comes out, then we know eternity hinges on this one man, Jesus Christ. As time is split, there would be a time before him and there would be a time after him. If the dead man comes out, then we know Christ does have the resurrecting power, and he brings it to us today, and it starts the second we allow Jesus into our lives. And in the very next verse, verse 44, it says that the dead man came out. Amen. We know that there is resurrection power in this building tonight. We know that the power of the Holy Spirit is here with us today, and he is asking you today, do you believe this? Do you believe that Jesus did it then and there? Do you believe that the dead man came out, that whatever our Lazarus is, that Jesus has the power to do it again and to bring it out of our lives? Do you believe that? Friends, we're going to transition into a time now where we reflect. I feel like the Holy Spirit has been speaking to some of you guys today. We prepared for that. We have people in the back that are willing to pray with you, that are willing to do this journey with you. We have stations where you could reflect and spend time with the people that you came, that are here to pour into you and to give you the love of Jesus and help you experience heaven on earth today. If you don't feel like doing any of that, you can stay right where you are. We're going to have the band come up, and they're going to be continuing to play a song. But I hope and pray that whatever hardships come your way, whatever your Lazarus is, I pray that you may have the faith to confidently shout out that you do believe in the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. Can we all pray? God, if only you had been there, my brother would not have died. Martha said this in despair, in pain, and you stepped in and you changed the course of history forever, Lord God. You stepped into her life. You stepped into Lazarus' life and you made them whole again. And we believe that you had the power to do it then, and you have the power to do it again. In our lives here today, Holy Spirit, come. Fill us with your presence. Give us the courage to scream back that we do believe in the resurrection power of Jesus Christ, now and forevermore. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.